Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul. Worship his holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul. I'll worship your holy name. The sun comes up, it's a new day dawning. It's time to sing your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening comes. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul. Worship his soul. Oh my soul, worship your holy name. I'll worship your holy name. God, I'll worship your holy
Would the congregation please rise and face the processional cross?
Thank you.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
All have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. God calls us to confess our sins. We observe a moment of silence for personal reflection and confession. God, you formed us in the womb, and you shape our lives to love and honor you and our neighbors. Yet we are by nature sinful and separated from you. We sin against you in thoughts, words, and actions. For the sake of Jesus, who was tempted in every way as we are, and yet without sin, we pray for your forgiveness. For our sake, he made him to be sin who knew no sin, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. Therefore, by the command of Jesus Christ, I forgive you all of your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Thanks be to God. Amen. You may be seated for our hymn. If you'd like to follow along for the rite of baptism, it's in your pew hymnal, page 268. Dearly beloved, Christ our Lord says in the last chapter of Matthew, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit." In the last chapter of Mark, our Lord promises, "Whoever believes and is baptized will be saved." And the Apostle Peter has written, "Baptism now saves you." The Word of God also teaches that we are all conceived and born sinful and are under the power of the devil until Christ claims us as his own. We would be lost forever unless delivered from sin, death, and everlasting condemnation. But the Father of all mercy and grace has sent his Son, Jesus Christ, who atoned for the sins of the whole world, that whoever believes in him should not perish but have eternal life. I ask you now, how is she to be named? Athena J. Perdue, receive the sign of the cross, both upon your forehead and upon your heart, marking you as one redeemed by Christ the crucified. Let us pray. Almighty and eternal God, according to your strict judgment, you condemned the unbelieving world through the flood, yet according to your great mercy, you preserved believing Noah and his family, eight souls and all. You drowned hard-hearted Pharaoh and all his host in the Red Sea, yet led your people Israel through the water on dry ground, foreshadowing this washing of your holy baptism. Through the baptism in the Jordan of your beloved Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, you sanctified and instituted all waters to be a blessed flood and a lavish washing away of sin. We pray that you would behold Athena according to your boundless mercy, and bless her with true faith by the Holy Spirit, that through this saving flood all sin in her, which has been inherited from Adam, and which she herself has committed since, would be drowned and die. Grant that she be kept safe and secure in the holy ark of the Christian Church, being separated from the multitude of unbelievers, and serving your name at all times with a fervent spirit and a joyful hope, so that with all believers in your promise, she would be declared worthy of eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. From ancient times, the Church has observed the custom of appointing sponsors for baptismal candidates and catechumens. In the Lutheran Church, sponsors are to confess the faith expressed in the Apostles' Creed and taught in the Small Catechism. They are, whenever possible, to witness the baptism of those they sponsor. They are to pray for them, support them in their ongoing instruction and nurture in the Christian faith, and encourage them towards faithful reception of the Lord's Supper. They are at all times to be examples to them of the holy life of faith in Christ and love for neighbor. I ask you now, is it your intention to serve Athena as sponsors in the Christian faith? If so, then say yes with the help of God. God enable you both to will and to do this faithful and loving work, and with his grace fulfill what we are unable to do. Amen. Hear the Holy Gospel according to St. Mark. They brought young children to Jesus that he might touch them, but the disciples rebuked those who brought them. When Jesus saw it, he was greatly displeased and said to them, "Let the little children come to me, and do not forbid them, for of such is the kingdom of God. Assuredly, I say to you, whoever does not receive the kingdom of God as a little child will by no means enter it." And he took them up in his arms, put his hands on them, and bless them. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Together we pray the prayer that our Lord himself has taught to us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. The Lord preserve your coming in and your going out from this time forth till forevermore. Amen. And being as Athena is not able to answer for herself, Dad and sponsors, I will ask you to answer these questions on her behalf. Do you renounce the devil and all his works and all his ways? If so, then say, yes, I renounce them. Do you believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, and in the Holy Spirit? If so, then say, yes, I believe. Athena J. Purdue, I baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The Almighty God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has given you new birth of water and the Spirit, and has forgiven you all of your sins, strengthen you with his grace now and unto life everlasting. Amen. Receive this burning light to show that you have received Christ, who is the light of the world. Live always in the light of Christ and be ever watchful for his coming, that you may meet him with joy and enter with him into the marriage feast of the Lamb and his kingdom, which has no end. We pray. Almighty and most merciful God and Father, we thank and praise you that you graciously preserve and enlarge your family and have granted Athena the new birth in holy baptism and made her a member of your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord, and an heir of your heavenly kingdom. We humbly implore you that as she has now become your child, you would keep her in her baptismal grace, that according to your good pleasure, she may faithfully grow to lead a godly life to the praise and honor of your holy name. And finally, with all your saints, obtain the promised inheritance in heaven. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And Lord and giver of life, look with kindness upon Tyler and upon all parents. Let them ever rejoice in the gift that you have given them. Enable them to be teachers and examples of righteousness for their children. Strengthen them in their own baptism, that they may share eternally with their children the salvation that you have given to them. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you now and always. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Gracious God, form the church as the place where your gracious gifts find full expression. Let your mercy flow to all who hunger and thirst for righteousness. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
First reading for the Festival of Reformation is from the Revelation to St. John, chapter 14. Then I saw another angel flying directly overhead with an eternal gospel to proclaim to those who dwell on earth, to every tribe and nation and language and people. And he said with a loud voice, "Fear God and give him glory, because the hour of his judgment has come. And worship him who made heaven and earth, the sea and the springs of water." This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The epistle lesson is from Romans chapter 3. Now we know that whatever the law says, it speaks to those who are under the law, so that every mouth may be stopped and the whole world may be held accountable to God. For by the works of the law, no human being will be justified in his sight, since through the law comes knowledge of sin. But now the righteousness of God has been manifested apart from the law, although the law and the prophets bear witness to it, the righteousness of God through faith in Jesus Christ for all who believe. For there is no distinction, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God, and are justified by his grace as a gift through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus, whom God put forward as a propitiation by his blood to be received by faith. This was to show God's righteousness, because in his divine forbearance he had passed over former sins, so that he might be just and the justifier of the one who has faith in Jesus. Then what has become of our boasting? It is excluded. By what kind of law? By a law of works? No, but by the law of faith. For we hold that the one is justified by faith apart from the works of the law. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. We rise for the reading of the Holy Gospel. Alleluia.
Alleluia.
Fear not, little flock, Alleluia. The Holy Gospel according to St. John, the 8th chapter. So Jesus said to the Jews who had believed in him, "If you abide in my word, you are truly my disciples, and you will know the truth, and the truth will set you free." They answered him, "We are offspring of Abraham and have never been enslaved to anyone. How is it that you say you will become free?" Jesus answered them, "Truly, truly, I say to you, everyone who commits sin is a slave to sin. The slave does not remain in the house forever. The son remains forever. So if the son sets you free, you will be free indeed." This is the gospel of the Lord. Together we join our voices as we boldly confess our faith in the words of the Nicene Creed. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of his Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten, not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us men and for our salvation came down from heaven and was incarnate by the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary and was made man and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried, and the third day he rose again according to the Scriptures and ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of the Father. And he will come again with glory to judge both the living and the dead, whose kingdom will have no end. And I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshipped and glorified, who spoke by the prophets. And I believe in one holy Christian and apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins, and I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. You may be seated, and all of the children that are present with us, we would invite you forward before Sunday school. Good morning. How are we doing this morning? Excellent. What have I brought with me this morning? A life jacket. Why do we wear life jackets? So we don't sink like a rock. Right. We wear life jackets. If you were on a boat and you weren't wearing a life jacket and you fell overboard, what do you think would happen? You could sink, but hopefully, what's the captain going to do of the boat? Turn it around. Okay? What else is he hopefully going to do? Save you, but he's got to give you something to save you. Yeah, a floaty, a lifesaver, right? Sometimes you see them, they're white, and they've got like red rings on them, and they float in the water, and so they might throw that to you. Well, I want you to imagine if you were on a big boat, and you fell overboard, okay? And the captain comes over to the edge. He stops the boat, and he comes over to the edge, and he says, "Hey, how's it going down there? Do you want to be saved?" And you're going to go, "Yeah, of course I want to be saved. Help me out here." And he said, "Well, how about this? You climb up halfway, and then I'll help you the rest of the way." Is that going to help you out?
Yeah.
Not really. Not really. No, that's not going to help you out, right? Especially if it's a really big ship. You might not be able to climb halfway up. Or what if he says, "Well, you swim all the way to the boat, and then I'll send a ladder down so that you can get up." Would that help you? Maybe. I mean, it might help you a little bit, at least, but you got to swim. What if you fell and this is a big ship and you're really far away? That's a long swim. You might get tired, right? You won't? You probably wouldn't. What if the captain came over and he said, well, what have you done that's good today? I'll save you if you can tell me some things that you did that were good. Does that seem fair? No, probably not. We'd all be in big trouble, right? What does the captain normally do? He just throws the life preserver and you grab on, and then they pull you to safety and they bring you up onto the ship, right? Right? That's how they save you when you are sinking, when you are drowning, when you have fallen off the ship. Well, many years ago, there was a man by the name of Martin Luther. And Martin Luther lived during a time where the church was telling people that if you want to be saved, you have to be a good person. And Martin Luther started reading the Bible, and he said, you know what? That's not what the Bible says. This is what the Bible says. I'm going to read it to you exactly. We are saved by grace through faith, and it is a gift from God. So we're saved, but is it anything that we do? It's grace. Grace is not something that we do. Grace is something that God does for us. And what has God done for us? He's done lots of things for us, but what's the most important thing, the thing that has saved us from our sin? Yeah, he died on the cross, and he rose from the dead, right? And so by dying and rising, we have been saved. So if it were up to us, if we had to be a good person, could we do it? We couldn't be good enough, right? We could never do enough good things to save ourselves. But that's why we have Jesus. That's why Jesus came. He came to die, to rise, to save you and me and all of these fine folks here behind you from sin and from death and from the devil. And so now we get to live as new people. We should tell other people about Jesus. We get to share Jesus with other people. It is God who has saved us. He is the one who preserves us. He is the one who throws us a life preserver. He is the one who brings us into a relationship with him. Okay, so let's go to God, fold our hands, bow our heads, and ask him and thank him for that gift. We thank you, God, for sending Jesus to save us from our sins, for throwing us a life preserver of sorts by dying on the cross to take them away. Thank you for throwing us that life preserver and for saving our eternal lives. We pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, you guys can head to the back this morning with Miss Paulette. And we will continue our time of worship with our sermon hymn, A Mighty Fortress Is Our God. Grace, mercy, and peace be unto you from God our Heavenly Father, from our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. Let us pray. O Lord, may the words of my mouth and the meditation of our hearts be pleasing in your sight, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. So I want you to think back a few years. It's not all that long. Most people in this room were alive when this movie came out. It was a movie that was produced by Steven Spielberg, and it had two very well-known actors in it, Leonardo DiCaprio and Tom Hanks. They were kind of the main characters. The title of the movie was Catch Me If You Can. Who has seen that movie? Okay, so if you haven't seen that movie, Leonardo DiCaprio's character is a man by the name of Frank. This is a young Leo, okay? And Frank is this young man, and he impersonates basically everybody in order that he can fraudulently cash checks and et cetera, if you've seen the movie. But he impersonates all of these different people. He impersonates a Pan Am pilot. He impersonates an attorney. He impersonates a medical doctor. And he even impersonates being a Lutheran. His lies are so convincing that he convinces this nurse at the hospital that he's working at as a doctor to fall madly in love with him, and he falls in love with her. In fact, his lies are so convincing that he even begins to believe them himself. But it doesn't take long for the FBI to catch up to him, and of course, the lead FBI agent is played by Tom Hanks. And he catches up to him at this one point in the movie at his engagement party, where Frank is in getting engaged, and they're celebrating this party. And Frank runs into the room kind of in a frazzle because the FBI is hot on his tail. They've showed up at the party, and he makes this confession to his soon-to-be bride. He says, "Honey, I'm not a doctor. I never went to medical school or a Harvard graduate. I'm not even a Lutheran." And she stops, and she responds, and she says, "But Frank, what do you mean? You're not Lutheran." For her, and possibly for her father, who was a high-powered attorney, that was the most important part of his identity, that he was a Lutheran. I want you to ask yourself that question this morning. What does it mean to be Lutheran? What is Reformation Day all about? Is it just a celebration of historical and cultural heritage? In order to answer those questions, we have to begin with a very un-Lutheran idea. So don't pass out, anybody. Righteous works are necessary for salvation. Or are they? Martin Luther had been taught that God would only love him if he kept all of God's commandments. That's what the church taught Martin. That God would only love him if he kept all of God's commandments. And Luther, he tried. He tried really hard. He tried to meet the demands of God because he was afraid. He tried to meet the demands out of fear of God's wrath and punishment, the punishment that was coming his way if he failed to keep up his end of the deal. Judgment Day is no medieval concoction. It's not something that they just conjured up in their minds. The scripture clearly teaches about this day and its coming and the events that surround it. But Luther was convinced, not in God's grace, but rather out of fear, that he must keep the law and he must keep it perfectly. The more he tried to do so, the more he despaired, the more he became anxious, the more he grew weary about his lot in life. The problem was that Luther read the law not with his eyes on Jesus, but Luther was focused on himself. He hated the phrase, the righteousness of God. That phrase appears many times in the New Testament, and he hated it because he originally thought that it referred to the righteousness that God demanded for him, that he must be righteous. He believed that he had to keep every aspect of the law, keep every command and statute of God perfectly. For Luther, he felt early on as if he was this convicted criminal that was sitting there in the courtroom and he was without a defense attorney. But But the heart of the matter and the truth is that Luther was not alone. This teaching was permeating every corner of the people's lives in Wittenberg at the time. It's evident. We know this from history. November 1st, 1517, when the people of Wittenberg, they lined out upside the castle church. And they lined up there for a very specific reason. They did so that they might pay money to the church for the opportunity to venerate Duke Frederick's collection of over 1,700 relics. That seems ridiculous to you and to me. Who would pay to venerate relics? But brothers and sisters, we have to remember that these people believed that proper veneration could earn them up to 2 million years off their purgatory sentence. The castle church door, yes, you may know it. It is that famous door upon which Luther nailed his 95 theses just one day earlier, October 31st, because Luther knew that this would be happening the very next day. For the righteous works, the sinner's case is hopeless. We need to hear that. We need to be reminded of that. Because there are times in all of our lives, myself included, when we almost try to convince ourselves of our own righteousness, of our own deeds. We try to pat ourselves on the back for the good person that we are and where that's maybe getting us with God. We assume that if we take God's rules, if we take our faith seriously, if we put in the effort, then we will pass muster with God. Or like Frank, who puts on that pilot's uniform, even though he knows nothing about flying planes, we don this costume of outward righteousness, believing more and more that that's who we really are, but all we are doing is lying to ourselves. We dress up in an attempt to fool ourselves into believing that we are a good person, that we have done good and righteous things before the eyes of God, and he will certainly reward us for such deeds. You've probably heard the old human trick. It's the trick of human nature. If you can't measure up, change the measure. Right? If you can't measure up, change the measure. This is the world today. This is us today. We are this exactly. We assume that the rules are meant to be bended or shaped or molded or stretched. We do this all the time. I do this every time I get in a car and it says 55 miles per hour on the speed limit sign and I'm going 60 because I think I can get away with it. We do this with politics. We do this in financial markets. We do this all the time where we try to stretch the rules or bend them to suit our needs. Or worse, even worse than just bending the guidelines or the rules, we follow the world outright. We give ourselves over to things of the world. We try to adapt God's law to our contemporary lifestyle, to what's relevant, what's going on in the world, because it's the in thing, it's the cool thing, it's the thing to be doing and believing and saying. Instead, we should be seeking to adapt our lifestyle to the Word of God. People do this. Churches do this, sadly. They want God's Word to fit how they want to live. We've all probably done this. We've done something, and maybe someone will even call us on it. That doesn't really apply to me, not in this circumstance, not in this case. That applies to other people, bad people. This is the way we function. That is until the prosecutor catches up with us. Paul writes just prior to this morning's epistle in chapter 2, he says this, "Therefore, you have no excuse. You have no excuse, O man, every one of you who judges. For in passing judgment on another, you condemn yourself, because you, the judge, practice the very same things." Paul then goes on, and he tells us that the word of God stops our mouths. Now we know that whatever the law says, it speaks to those who are under the law, so that every mouth may be stopped. and the whole world may be held accountable to God. I want you to think of a judge sitting in a courtroom, and he cuts short this futile attempt at a suspect who is trying to present themselves as being innocent. That's what's going on here. For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. Truly righteous works can only come from a sinless person. Paul writes about that following verse 23. Doug just read that a few moments ago. For everyone has sinned, we all fall short of God's glorious standard. Yet God in his grace, freely makes us right in his sight. He did this through Jesus Christ when he freed us from the penalty of our sin. You see, Christ alone, true God and true man, is the only one who can and has fulfilled the law perfectly, and he did it in love for you and for me. He has shown each of us that God is just and that God upholds the law, not by anything that we do, but by doing what you and I could not do for ourselves. He fulfills the law perfectly in our place. With the work of Jesus, the church stands or it fails. If you have your bulletin there, look at verse 26. It says, for he was looking ahead and included them in what he would do in this present time. God did this to demonstrate his righteousness, for he himself is fair and just, and he makes sinners right in his sight when they believe in Jesus. So you see, where the truth is preached, where the truth is taught, where the sinner who confesses and repents, there they find the certainty of salvation in Jesus Christ alone. There, he or she, you and I, find it in the water and the word. We got to witness that in a beautiful way this morning and recall our own baptism. We get to hear it in the proclamation of forgiveness from Christ himself, who says, you are forgiven. We get to taste it as we put the body and blood of Jesus Christ upon our lips. You are saved by nothing, nothing but the righteous work of Jesus Christ. And when that spiritual reality catches up with us under God's judgment, the bluff of our own righteousness is called. The gig is up. And then Christ will not ask you, are you Lutheran? What he'll ask you is, do you believe that my works alone save you? That is why we, the church, proclaim the full weight of the law of God and the even greater weight of the gospel from the pulpit and at the font and here from the altar of God. Such teaching and such practice are marks of the church's identity. And so, brothers and sisters, let our prayer on this celebration of the Reformation be that our Lord of the church will keep us steadfast in this faith, believing in the work of Christ, without which no one becomes righteous. May God grant that unto us all. Amen. And now may the peace of God that surpasses all understanding, may it guard and keep your hearts and your minds through faith in Christ Jesus unto life everlasting. Amen. We rise for the prayer of the church. Prayers this morning for Hertha Ferguson, Wayne Dean, Tom Christo, Alice Muggy. Wayne just had surgery this past Saturday. It was successful, but he has a long road of recovery. Also prayers, surgery upcoming this Wednesday for Carolyn Coleman. Louise Fairbanks went to the hospital this morning with some complications. Don't know a whole lot more than that. Prayers of healing for Wilfred Thibault. Prayers for Darlene's Jacob and Darlene Stawinski as they celebrate their anniversary. And then finally, prayers for Julie Miller, who has surgery upcoming this week. Let us pray for the whole people of God in Christ Jesus and all people according to their needs. Mighty fortress, rock of refuge, sustain your church. Deliver her from error and preserve in her the proclamation of your gospel, that it would resound to every nation, tribe, people, and language, and that all may fear and give you glory. Lord, in your mercy. Rock of refuge, bless all ministers of your word. Help them rightly to preach your law so that all are held accountable to you without excuse, and to joyfully proclaim your gospel, that all would know Jesus Christ as their Savior. Lord, in your mercy. Mighty fortress, make us truly your disciples. Keep us in your word. Free us from all error. Make our homes and families peaceful. Preserve all fathers and encourage them for their godly task, that children would be brought up in the fear and instruction of the Lord. Lord, in your mercy. Rock of refuge, bless all civil authorities, especially our president, Congress, governor, legislature, all who make, administer, and judge our laws. Protect them from the temptation that beset their offices, and grant them wisdom and courage to serve with integrity. Lord, in your mercy. Heavenly Father, be near to all who cry out to you for healing of body and soul. Especially, we remember this morning, Hertha, Wayne, Tom, Alice, Carolyn, Louise, Wilfred, Julie, and all those we name in our hearts. Grant them release from their afflictions according to your will. Sustain their hope in the full and final healing that awaits them at the day of Christ's appearing. Lord, in your mercy. Heavenly Father, bless all those who give thanks. Especially this day, we give thanks for the love that brought together Jacob and Darlene Stawinski. May that love continue to grow as does their love for you. Lord, in your mercy. Mighty fortress, rock of refuge, we give you thanks for all of your servants who have departed this life in faith. We especially bless you today for the great reformers of your church who call us back to the gospel and to the righteousness we have in Christ alone. Keep us in fellowship with them and bring us at last to our heavenly home to see our Redeemer face to face. Through the same Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. We continue with the service of the sacrament. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly good, right, and salutary that we should at all times and in all places give thanks to you, Holy Lord, Almighty Father, everlasting God, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who gave his life on the cross in order that our hearts may be reshaped to reflect not our own goodness, but God's. Therefore, with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify your glorious name, evermore praising you and saying, Lord Jesus Christ, in the night when he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me." In the same way also, he took the cup after supper, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the New Testament of my blood, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of all of your sins. This too do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." The peace of the Lord be with you always.
Amen. O Christ, thou Lamb of God, that takest away.
blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, and strengthen and preserve you, keep you in the one true faith, now into life everlasting. Depart in his peace. Amen.
Praise thee, bless thee, and adore thee in thee.
his peace. Amen. Blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus made strengthen and preserve. rise. Let us pray. You, O Lord, are the potter, we the clay. By Christ's body and blood in the sacrament, you shape us to be the body of Christ. Send us out from this table, forgiven and restored, that we may freely bear the fruit of the Spirit in our lives. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord look upon you with his favor and give to you his peace. Amen. You may be seated for our closing hymn, The Church's One Foundation. As always, last page of the announcements are things happening this week, so please take note of that. A couple of things to turn your attention to. The bazaar is less than 3 weeks away. It is on November 18th. If you haven't signed up to work or to make something and you want to do that, please do it now so that Board of Fellowship can kind of plan for who's going to be here and what they're going to have. There are sign-up sheets in the gym. If you sign up to make a quiche, Julie Miller has the supplies for you also in the gym, so please see her. Tuesday is Trunk or Treat. We would love for you to come spend an hour and a half, 2 hours here. Decorate your trunk. Don't decorate your trunk. I mean, we'd love for you to participate and decorate your trunk. But if you just want to pass out candy, that's fine. Come and do that. We have games inside for the kids. If the weather's nice, we'll be outside. Otherwise, we'll bring stuff in the gym. It starts at 5 o'clock, but if you are going to set up a trunk, please be here at 4:30. There's also sign-ups in the gym for cookies, ciders, all those other things. It says in here, sign-ups in the gym for cookies, cider, working at a game booth, as well as passing out. So it's missing something. I think it's passing out candy. We don't want anyone passing out, so please don't sign up for that. The Thanksgiving Compassion Project is also underway. There's a sign-up sheet on the bulletin board. That is to help families in our community by providing them a Thanksgiving meal this year. So please take a look at that. Last thing from me is the Children's Christmas Program. Can you believe that, folks? I just said Christmas. It's going to be here before you know it. It is going to start practices on Sunday, November 12th after church. So if you have a child, student, grandchild, and we'd love for them to be in it. We'd love for you to bring them. So that will be after church on those Sundays listed in the bulletin. You ready? Go in peace, serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Oh, I'll come back for it. Thanks.